tribute to this session in memory of Pomarancho. Here are the topics I want to cover. During the last 50 years, we had a remarkable development in particle physics. It changed quite totally. What I want to first discuss is some qualitative properties of the theory that we now have to describe the particles, and then turn to the methods used that can be used at low energies. I first encountered the name of Pomarančuk in connection with high energy physics. It was mentioned just in the last lecture about the Pomarančuk theorem for the asymptotic behavior of cross section. My talk is the opposite end of the energy scale. I start with qualitative aspects of the standard. The standard model is really a miracle. We know that the microscopic world has three different kinds of interactions: strong, electromagnetic, weak. They are qualitatively very different. Nevertheless, we now know that all three of them are generated by gauge fields, and I want to discuss why that is possible. We have the same mathematical structure for qualitatively totally different forces. This is the picture for how the photons interact with the charged particle, or how the gluons interact with a colored particle, like a quark, or how the W's of Z's will interact with a electron pair or a quark. Here we have quantum electrodynamics that describes this interaction. The source of the field is the charge, the electric charge. In case of the strong interactions, the source of the gauge field is color. The particles which mediate the force are the gluons. And over here we have the W's and Z's which couple to flavor and transmit the weak interaction. At short distances, all of the forces obey the inverse square law, which means that the potential energy is inversely proportional to 1 over the distance. The constant here in front is a pure number, so the three interactions can be characterized by pure numbers. One is the fine structure constant that he knows in so long time. There is an analogous constant for the strong interaction, analogous one for the weak interaction. Both these are dimensionless. So, why then can the three interactions be so different? In particular, the strong interactions bind the nucleons to nuclei, they have attractive properties. Weak interactions make particles decay, it's qualitatively different. Also, a 1 over r potential transmits a long-range force. But we know that the strong and the weak interactions are both of short range, so how can they be transmitted by a 1 over r potential? Then you can see the photons by eye, but you cannot see the gluons. There are qualitative differences. I want to discuss these. There are two aspects of the standard model which are relevant for understanding these qualitative differences. One property is that the vacuum is a highly non-trivial state in quantum field theory. It matters what the vacuum is. The other is that photons do not have electric charge, whereas gluons have color. That makes a qualitative difference. I will discuss that. In the standard model, the vacuum is a condensate of Higgs particles. When photon travels through this condensate, it doesn't take notice because these particles don't have any electric charge. Photons only see particles that have a charge. So the vacuum is transparent for the photon because it doesn't have any electric charge there. The same applies for color. Gluons can traverse the vacuum without noticing the Higgs particles because they don't have color. The only thing they have is flavor. So the W's and Z waves, when they go through the vacuum, they interact with these particles laying around. If they are of low frequency, they will not be able to propagate at all. They get stuck in this forest of Higgs particles. And which means that for the weak waves, the vacuum is okay. It does not allow these particles to traverse the vacuum unless they have a lot of energy. Here is the standard graph of frequency versus wave number. The difference is that in some cases we have a gap here, in some we don't. The gap is given by the mass of the particles. So for the photons and the gluons, they are massless particles. Therefore, these two move at the velocity of light. The line here is totally straight. While the W and Z particles, they have mass because they have trouble moving through this medium, so they move at velocity less than light. You can calculate how far a wave can get if it has low frequency. It's given by the Compton wavelength of the corresponding particle. For the W's and the Z, this number is of the order of 10 to the minus 18 meters, which means that they do not get far away from the source if they have low energy. The effect on the interaction is quite easy to understand. Instead of a 1 over R law for the exchange of a W particle, for example, we have a 1 over R times e to the minus R over d, you come up with them. So because the force that is transmitted by a massive particle. That, of course, reduces the strength of the weak interaction. And since the quantity that stands here is the penetration depth, since that is very small, it means the weak interaction has short range. It also has an effect on the strength of the interaction at low energy, because what counts at the low energy is only the mean value of this Yukawa potential. And you can see for dimensional reasons, this is proportional to the penetration depth in square. And since that depth is very small, the effective weak interaction is very small. Now I come to the second issue. This was the business with the vacuum. I now come to the difference between QED and QCD, namely produced by the fact that the photons do not have electric charge, whereas the gluons have color. This is responsible for the fact that the electromagnetic and strong interactions are very different at low energies. I illustrate this here. On the left, I plot the positron. More precisely, I plot the density of charge in the vicinity of a positron. Here at the center sits the bare particle. It polarizes the vacuum and attracts mostly electrons so that the cloud that surrounds the positron is of opposite sign. This means that the total charge of the object is less than the bare charge. Or in other words, the vacuum shields the electric charge. Over here in QCD, it's similar. I plot the bare port here, and I look at the density of color, not at the density of charge. If they have a red quark, it means it makes a peak here at the center, and then it polarizes the vacuum and surrounds itself with quarks and antiquarks, like in the QED case. What is different is that you see here also a contribution from the gluons. The gluons themselves have color. So if I plot the density of color, I can see the gluon. If I plot the density of charge, I cannot see the photon. Of course, there is a cloud of photons here also, but it doesn't contribute to the charge density. That's the difference. In this case, it turns out that the effect from the gluons is larger than the one from the quarks, so that the net color is larger than the red color. In other words, the vacuum amplifies color, doesn't shield it. In short, the difference is that the polarization of the vacuum produced by a color source or by an electrical charge source is quite different. It has dramatic consequences. The Lagrangians of the two theories are not very different. But the properties of the strong and electromagnetic interactions are totally different at low energies. At high energies, they have a 1 over r kind of behavior, but that means short distances, they have 1 over r behavior. In fact, the field energy that surrounds an isolated quark is infinite. Because of this amplification of color, the total energy would be infinite. In other words, you cannot observe isolated colored objects. Color is compact, but you can only observe objects that are color neutral. It's quite different for the case of electromagnetic interaction, where the field energy of a charged particle is finite. That's why charge is not confined. One can observe electrons moving in isolation. It also means that what we know since a long time as the nuclear force is strong interaction between the baryons. That's a sort of van der Waals force. It's the force between neutral objects. The force inside these baryons or mesons ensures that you get altogether a charged neutral object like an atom in the case of the electromagnets. At large distances, the electromagnetic interaction remains weak. The number is about 1 over 137. It means that the photons and the leptons stay almost decoupled from the rest of the world. There's only this electromagnetic interaction that acts on them. Opposite is true for QCD. The forces become strong. The coupling constant takes values of order 1. That's why the gluons and the quarks are confined. In this case, one can use perturbations because the interaction stays weak. We can expand the powers of this constant. In QCD, we cannot because the constant becomes large where the energy is. It also means that the spectrum of states in QED, you can already see in the Lagrangian, there will be Dirac field for the electron, there will be electric potential for the photon, and you see a photon in the spectrum and an electron in the spectrum, it's the same. In QCD, that's not the case. You have quarks and gluons in the Lagrangian. In the spectrum, you have mesons and baryons, color neutral objects. Quite different degrees of freedom are seen in the spectrum as compared to what you see in the Lagrangian. This is why it took so long to find out that the strong interactions are mediated by a gauge field. Gauge fields were discovered early. For example, Pauli had found non-abelian gauge fields when trying to generalize the Pauli-Klein idea to more than five dimensions. Then one can have isometric groups which are larger than the U1 which characterizes electromagnetism. And so one gets non-abelian gauge fields in such a geometrical framework. Pauli dismissed this because he thought gauge invariance protects the photon from picking up mass, so it will protect these non-abelian gauge fields from protecting up, from getting mass, and therefore this cannot possibly have anything to do with the strong interaction which is struggling. It also means that these Kaplan constants are scale dependent. If the momentum scale is increased, then the electric charge goes up. If you look at the strong interaction coupling, it falls down. So we have a qualitative different behavior. The fall down is only logarithmic, that is to say it goes very small, it goes very slowly, but they come down. Strong interaction gets weaker, electromagnetic interaction gets stronger. There is an interesting possibility that they are actually getting the same strength if you go to short enough distance. We know that couplings do approach at low energies, if energy is increased, whether they actually meet is an open issue. Summary for this first part. One property is that the vacuum is opaque for the weak intermediate boson. If the energy is too small, below the rest mass of the rest energy of a W or a Z, then the weak interaction simply freezes out. It has no effect. So that the standard model then reduces to these two parts. Moreover, the electrodynamic part is stable in the infrared. The Kaplan constant is small and remains finite, does not blow up when the momentum scale becomes small. It's characterized by a number that is small. In effect, this means that the contributions from this QFT weak interaction, they are tiny at low energies. Those from the electromagnetic interaction are not quite that tiny, but they are small, they can be analyzed in terms of perturbation theory. In a sense, the standard model at low energy is just QCD plus torque. Here is the parameters that occur in the Lagrangian of QCD. So a coupling constant, there is a vacuum angle, and there are the quark masses. We have six different flavors. The pattern of quark masses is very strange. One mu is much, much smaller than MT. It's not understood at all. And of this whole list here, when I go to low energies, only two parameters are really important, GS and the sum of U and D mass. So these are the two parameters that are responsible for most of the low energy effects in the standard model. Of course, if one wants to have it quantitatively to good accuracy, then the rest has to be accounted for. I go to high energies, then the quarks and gluons have a coupling that goes down. So the interaction diminishes if I increase the energy scale. 2CD is called asymptotically free, that is to say at very high energies, quantum quarks behave like free particles. This means that one can use them to make perturbations here at high energy. The fields in the Lagrangian are indeed the fields useful to analyze the interaction, and one can treat it as a perturbation at high energies. In particular, one can, for example, analyze inclusive processes like an electron on a proton gives electron plus anything, cause this inelastic scattering. It can be calculated in powers of the strong coupling constant, and then the masses also enter. They depend on the Rankine scale like the strong coupling constant. One can analyze jets this way. There are also effective theories to cope with the fact that when some of the momentum becomes small, then there are infinite divergences because the coupling gets strong. If some of the loop momenta become soft or collinear, then you have to take that into account and what that can be done with effective. This is a very successful way of analyzing the theory. It works at high energies. Here is the result for the running of the strong coupling constant as a function of the scale. This is taken from the particle data booklet. You can also see here at the mass of the Z, the value of alpha is now known to this precision. Incidentally, this knowledge here is dominated by results coming from the lab. One example where you can see that the lattice actually is able to produce physics. Also, you see here two orders of magnitude in scale variation. It involves processes of very different scales. And the fact that alpha comes down when the scale is increased is quite well established.
Is it finite at the origin?
Sorry?
Is it finite at the origin?
That's a good question. The trouble is that the notion of the coupling over there is a very delicate notion. What do you mean by the coupling if you cannot two perturbations here in the cup.
Okay. But still, is it freezing? Sometimes it's called freezing.
Well, there are many people who know, could tell you exactly, but not everybody tells you the same.
Sorry.
Now I turn to QCD at low energies. We know that the strong interactions have a rich structure at low energies. There are mesons, there are baryons, there are resonances, bound states, nuclei, whatnot. Quite a complicated structure for a theory which has only, well, what was it, about 8 parameters. Low energies are not within the reach of perturbations either, and therefore it is not easy to work out what the standard model predicts at low energies. To study higher energies is one way to try to look behind the standard model. The alternative is to stay within the accuracy accessible with the energy, but to improve the accuracy, stay within the energy limit. If I want to follow this alternative, then I have to know about the low energy properties of QCD. There are many models to tell you what would happen around QE to zero. I list some here, there are many more. This is useful to develop some intuitive understanding of QCD, but it's totally useless if you want to test the standard model. Then accuracy is required and these models cannot offer. I start with a example of a low energy observable which we know to fantastic precision. It's the magnetic moment of the electron. It has been determined experimentally to this many digits, and you can see that the uncertainty starts here, which is the 13th digit. It's really a very accurate measurement. Also, the first few corrections here are easy to understand. They have to do with this graph here, which was first calculated by Schwinger and would by itself give a 0.00116 instead of this takes care of the main one. Essentially, we now know the deviation from G to 2, which follows if the Dirac equation would be valid. We know how the quantum field theory modifies this value. It modifies it only a little, and we know exactly how much it modifies. One of the higher order contributions is vacuum polarization. For example, the photon that is exchanged across here in Schwinger's diagram can produce an E plus C minus pair, or a pair of muons, or a pair of tauis. It can also produce a pair of quarks, which then emit gluons and have strong interaction among themselves. So this will not be a single quark line, but lots of diagrams with strong interaction. It's called hadronic vacuum polarization. It's generated by the quarks and the gluon. Now, unfortunately, we do not know the fine structure constant well enough. We know it took quite a few digits, but not well enough to make a test of whether this is correctly described the way we can calculate it. Contribution from that is too small. Also, the contribution from quantum flavor dynamics, that's to say from the weak interaction, is too small to really matter at the accuracy at which we can calculate the magnetic moment in terms of known quantum. What it does offer, the magnetic moment, is an excellent test of QED. So the fact that QED works can be tested very well. Unfortunately, the test does not cover the contribution from the other interactions. Situation is rather different for the muon. For the muon, experimental precision is about 3 orders of magnitude less. It's still interesting and highly non-trivial to get it to this many digits. I quote the calculation here for the theoretic prediction from the standard model, which is due to Jaeger, Lehner, and Niffeler. Yeah, the reason I quote is that they are my students and therefore they know what they are doing. There are many other calculations. In this case, the contributions from the vacuum polarization graph is quite essential. It's 100 times as big as the experimental error. Therefore, if in this calculation the hadronic vacuum polarization would have been dropped, we would have a discrepancy of the order of 100 experimental errors. It would be a very good indication for the presence of this vacuum polarization. There are other contributions like light by light scattering, which amounts to about 2 times the error. Weak interaction effects are about the same size. The discrepancy here amounts to 4.6 experimental errors. And since the theory also has an error in the prediction, this is somewhat more than 3 sigma. So we have a problem here. The measurement does test the theory what we want to test, but the test in a sense fails. There are 3 possibilities. Most interesting one is that this is an example for physics beyond the standard model. That's quite possible. Or it could also be that the calculation of the prediction of the standard model has an error somewhere. Finally, it's even possible that something went wrong with the experiment. It's decreasing likelihood that it's a possibility. If you want to check whether the standard model prediction, what the standard model prediction is, you need to know the contribution from lack of polarization to an accuracy of 1%. I said that the contributions and the tank is large as the other, therefore we need to know it very accurately. More of 3/4 of that contribution, they come from the region below 1%. And in this connection now I want to discuss the energy gap of QCD. QCD does have an energy gap, which means that it does not contain any massless particles in the spectrum, unlike electrodynamics, where we have photons, but no massless particles. The lightest particle in QCD is the pion. It's a bound state of quarks and gluons. Therefore, the energy gap of QCD is determined by the mass of the pion. Indeed, the pions are the most important particles contributions at low energy. If I look at what generates this vacuum polarization, it has a contribution from two pion intermediate states. That's this contribution here, and that almost exhausts the vacuum polarization, so it is really dominating. Pion physics is needed. The gap in QCD is remarkably small, only 140 MeV is the rest energy of the pion. Question, of course, is whether we understand why it is so small. Nambu found out why it is so small. He showed that this has to do with a hidden approximate symmetry. At that time, we did not have theories like QCD. The theory of the strong interaction was really a genuine mess of all sorts of attempts. He was nevertheless able to guess the right symmetry that is responsible for the fact that the pion is so light. The point is that Hamiltonian is approximately symmetric, but the state of lowest energy is not symmetric. And then talks of a hidden symmetry or a spontaneously broken symmetry. Moreover, he noticed that if there is a spontaneous symmetry breakdown, then necessarily there are massless particles. If the symmetry is only approximate, then there will be approximately massless. And we concluded that this is the particles that are generated by this spontaneous breakdown at the time. That really was a stroke of genius. So let's see where the symmetry of non-moves is found in QCD. It has to do with the fact that fermions have the property that if they don't have mass, then the left-handed and right-handed components lead a life of their own. You know this from the neutrini. It's also true, of course, if they are massless, then the left does not talk to the right. It often happens in the Swiss parliament. I don't know about yours, but in particle physics, this is interesting. In the limit, when mu and md are turned off, the Hamiltonian of QCD becomes invariant and an independent isospin rotation of the left-handed component and the right-handed components of U and D. I can rotate these two components with an isospin rotation without rotating the other and vice versa. The symmetry group is two isospin factors, so it's SU2 plus SU2. And that's exactly the symmetry that Nambu had guessed. We have three conserved currents, These are the pollinators here, they connect the up and down ports in this particular way. There are three conserved axial currents. And the charges that correspond to these currents commute with the Hamiltonian. So in the limit, when the port masses are turned off, we have an exact symmetry. As Nambu found out, the symmetry is not respected by the ground state. That is to say, the state of lowest energy is not invariant with respect to the full symmetry of the Lagrange. This was known to happen in magnets. It was a known phenomenon in solid state physics, and Nambu grew from there. You know that in a magnet, the interaction between the spin is fully rotation symmetric. However, the ground state has to choose one direction for magnetization. It can do that in any direction it wants. The ground state itself is not rotation invariant. Same happens in particle systems. So this gives rise to massless particles. Nowadays they are called Nambu Goldstone bosons. They carry the same quantum numbers as this state here. There are three of them. They have negative parity because this is an axial charge. They have spin zero, and it's an isospin triplet. In the limit when the quark masses are set equal to zero, tail symmetry is exact. In that limit, the spectrum of QCD contains massless ions. Now we know that chiral symmetry is not an exact symmetry. It would be exact if the masses were zero. The quark masses break the symmetry. One can isolate the term in the Hamiltonian of QCD which breaks the symmetry. It's the mass term of the quark. The rest is invariant. Why does this break the symmetry? Because if you write this out, you can see that this is a product of a left with a right-handed quark, and so it's not invariant under independent rotations of the left and right-handed topology. To the extent that mu and md are small, the main elements of H1 will be small, so that we have an approximate. Now, at the time when approximate symmetries were discovered, already SU3, or then the symmetry of Nambu, it was quite mysterious why nature should want to have symmetries, but not quite. Why should there be symmetries that are there and play a role that are not exact? For QCD, this is very natural. It simply so happens that the masses of the up and down quarks are very small. That's all there is to it. If they were zero, we would have a symmetry. If they are not quite zero, we have an approximation. One can treat this mass term here as a perturbation. The operator H0 describes the U and D quarks as massless. Only the other quarks are treated with their full mass. Their mass doesn't play any role in the connection with this chiral symmetry. So the spectrum of H0 contains massless ions, but this perturbation equips them with a mass. If I make an expansion in powers of mu and mb, I'm in effect doing a perturbation series where H1 is treated as a perturbation. The result of first order perturbation theory is here. It says that the square of the mass of the pion is proportional to the sum of mu and mg, and then some factor that is different from zero. Actually, what you know from perturbation theories that the mass would be the expectation values of perturbation. The statement here is that this expectation value in a pion can be reduced to the expectation value in the vacuum by using current particles. So in a sense, it's the product of the explicit breaking of the symmetry in the Hamiltonian with this ordered parameter, which is analogous to the magnetization, and has to do with the fact that the symmetry is spontaneously broken. Coefficient here is known, the pion decay constant. From the point of view of QCD, m pi squared is a function of the scale of the theory and of the quantum. Chirosymmetry tells us that if I put mu and md equal to zero, then m pi vanishes, because I then have a spontaneously broken symmetry and it's called strong boson, non-Rudolf strong boson. Gilman Holt Zellner formula is a chirp to you, simply gives us the first turn in the expansion of m pi squared in powers of mu and md. It shows that this size of m pi, that is to say the size of the energy gap in QCD, is controlled by mu and md. You understand why the gap is small. It's because mu and md happen to be small. Of course, you would like to know why they are small, as we don't know. This is only the leading term, some linear in the quark masses. There will be terms quadratic, cubic, and so forth. It's the first term in a perturbation series. Here are some checks done on the lattice. Actually, these are rather old checks now. I don't show you the newer ones, because in the newer ones, usually what is plotted is m pi squared divided by the quark mass. And shows you more details, but to see the basic facts that indeed m pi squared grows in proportion to the quark mass is quite terrible. The quark masses here are rather large. They are such that the pion mass for this point would be 670, that is to say more than 3 times larger than in nature. Physics is done here. This is another such block. The proportionality of m pi squared to the quark mass holds to values of the quark mass which are about 10 times bigger than in nature. This is nature. This is the range where it holds. I want to underline that the quality of this data by now is impressive. People are able to simulate the theory without quenching. They can reach small quark masses. The mean mass of up and down, or the mass of the strange quarks, they are now known to about 3%. The ratio is now even better. This is the lattice number for the ratio. What is not so well known is the ratio of U over D. Among the three masses, U, D, and S, there are two ratios. One is known well, the other is not so known well. The reason is that here, electromagnetism is important. It also, this is a ratio that breaks isospin. And electromagnetism also breaks isospin. So one has to understand how much comes from where. One can do this on a lattice, however, with much less confidence. I mean, the QED part, for the time being, is simulated with quenched approximation, and also it's difficult to control finite size effects if there are massless particles. In this case, we have photons with massless
particles. What time do you need?
Yes, my 45 minutes are over. Well, I can stop anytime, just
tell me.
Let me see. Well, the whole rest is about the checklist theory. Let's go to the conclusion. I show you one thing. One can, for example, work out with the effective theory. One can work out the correction to the Gell-Mann-Oxrenner formula. The leading term is the Gell-Mann-Oxrenner term. And then there is a correction which has 1,000 and more and has a logarithm. And by now one can determine the scale there on the lattice also quite well. We had a simple crude guess in 84, and by now it's known much better. If you compare the numbers here, the error has been reduced by about an order of magnitude. Then I was discussing, planning to discuss how the pions interact with low energies. That's important for many of the quantities, understanding pion form factors and whatnot. My conclusion is short. The standard model is a precision theory at low energies, and it's a fascinating issue to work out its consequences. There are models, but they are a meager replacement for the real thing. Much work remains to be done. Sorry, you see it better this way? Much work remains to be done. The methods that can be used for this is lattice simulations, effective field theory methods, and dispersion theory. And of course, you would like to find out what hangs behind the standard model. It's not easy to do that at low energy. I gave you one example with the muon, magnetic moment. But it's not easy to do this at higher energies either, because that is relatively expensive. So, thank you.
Is there a question?
Is simply an absolutely fantastic development that they were initiating. It took us, how much, 40 years to give them, to give Nambu the Nobel Prize. 50 years.
Nobel Prize has dramatized the situation. I think that the contribution of the thing of it should remain.
Yes.
Because many people, in fact, think that the Nambu is
yes. I know the calculation in quite some detail. We did some calculations on that myself. I see no way at all to explain it in terms of standard things like, let's say, light by light scattering. You would have to distort it entirely to explain. Also, I think it's quite unlikely that this experimental number is not right, but there will be a new measurement by the same detection. My conclusion is that this is standard model. This is beyond standard model physics. What exactly, unfortunately, there is no proposal that could solve two of the puzzles we have. We have several puzzles, like dark matter and this. Could you do it with supersymmetry, explain the two? The answer is no. You can explain one, but then you need a different degree of freedom for the other. For me, this means it's not honest.
So,
what can you tell me about the discussions with Lemchik?
Yeah, that's a very interesting thing. Unfortunately, I have to dodge out. It's not understood. It's a very nice measurement. Some of the people doing the theory, they know what they do. Some. But it's not explained. So this is another good example for why it is worth investigating QCD at low energies and see whether we actually understand. It could hide that we do not understand one effect that shows up in between the ramp shift.
The problem is that you never measure the perfection of the orange in scatter. You always get some
Yes, whenever we do anything in theory, we use extrapolation.
Yes.
And the question whether you understand that or you don't is crucial. But I cannot claim that this problem would solve it. You should fight for somebody who extrapolates properly. I don't think so. It's an essential problem.
Because in atomic physics, you obtain just the R square.
Yes. And quite generally, in hadronic physics, to do things at the level of 1% is demanding. It's
right.
Not a simple thing.
Right.
And so, one has to investigate and find out.
So, are there some any questions?
Last one.
Maestro.
But it's very, no, it's very important that you would tell it loud.
Something aside.
What is something?
So, let me thank you very much for.
I'm sorry, I have lost somewhere around my bed, small black bed. And please look around. Похоже, нет.
Let me continue. Second talk is just reflecting my frequency to organize computers in Landau Institute. Quantum spin liquids, hypothesis of Paterancu, resonance, valentness, connections, Amundsen connection and modern state of situation.